Hello.
John, how's it going? It's D. Simon here in Harrison calling you from Sick and Wrong. Thanks for being on the show today.
No problem. Glad to do it.
Yeah, so you're the owner of the what's known as the Alien Ranch, also known as the Stardust Ranch in Buckeye, Arizona. Where exactly is Buckeye?
Well, it's actually Rainbow Valley, which is about 35 minutes southwest of Phoenix. Buckeye is the second largest city in as far as landmass goes in Arizona.
All right, so not that far from Phoenix. Is the ranch still on the market currently?
Well, we're taking offers. We have met all our expectations as far as prices go, but we're taking backup offers, and we're actually at the point now where we're kind of, I don't want to call it a bidding war, but we have two offers that have already met the $5 million requirement.
Wow. So it costs $5 million to buy the ranch. So now at this point, are these two people like interested in I think, would you have a horse rescue? Are they interested in using the ranch for like cattle or something? Or are they mostly interested in the fact that it's notorious for aliens?
Yeah, they're totally interested in the paranormal side of the whole thing. I mean, all the horses are going with us to Maine, and you know, we're basically stripping the property of, you know, everything that's, you know, not related to specifically the property. Disney has just announced that they're putting in a huge, you know, $1 billion water park and an extravaganza like Disneyland. I guess in Florida, they're going to build one here in the desert.
Well, that's going to boost the property value for sure.
It seems to be making it, apparently very attractive all of a sudden.
Well, hopefully the aliens don't find out about the water park. You know, what they'll do with the water.
Yeah, I'm not too worried about that.
So how long have you owned the ranch?
21 years. I moved in June 1st with my wife of 1996.
And did you know about any paranormal or extraterrestrial activity prior to purchasing it?
No, I had no idea at all. I mean, about as close as I got to the paranormal was, you know, the X-Files. I had no idea I was going to become one.
Did the previous owners ever, like, give you a clue, say, hey, you know, every now and then we get a couple alien abductions happening?
No, they were military, Air Force people, and literally our real estate agent from Century 21 did everything, and we really never had much contact.
And so you don't know if they, so you have no idea if they had any contact?
No, sir, I don't.
No.
What is interesting is that since, you know, all the sort of the fanfare that's associated with this in the media, the original owner, the wife of the original owner, has popped up, and she said, yeah, we built the place, I guess, like in 1977 or 76. And the reason she never wanted to live on the property was because of the fact that she was having these experiences apparently out here as well.
Whoa, that's interesting.
So, yeah, so she added confirmation to the whole thing. She actually, I guess she got hold of Channel 3 here in Phoenix and gave them the information. And apparently it's already being printed on Google with her response to the original, piece that went on there.
So if you knew about any of this alien activity, would that have deterred you from purchasing the home, or would you have been like, I don't care?
No, I would have moved as far away from it as possible. I'm a social worker, I'm a therapist, I'm a musician, I'm a writer, I'm a lot of things. But, I never wanted anything to do with the paranormal.
Wow. Yeah. So it's unfortunate that you had to experience this. So how soon after moving into the home did you have your first, I guess, paranormal encounter?
The first 4 hours.
Wow. Well, what happened?
I was literally in a position where I was starting to unpack stuff. And, well, actually, even before that, what happened was is that when we pulled up to move in, the people hadn't moved out yet. And then when we inquired why they hadn't moved, we called the realtor and said, hey, you know, we're not looking for roommates here. We're looking to have these folks move. We paid them cash. You know, how's this work? And, you know, he said, I'll get him out of there. And he said, go eat lunch, go eat breakfast, go eat dinner, go to the movies, you know, give us about 12 hours and then come back and move your stuff in. So we came back later that night, and indeed all their stuff was gone. But the problem was the entire household was now in the 10-foot deep diving pool. And so all their stuff was out in the water, and they were nowhere to be found. And I spent the next week dredging the pool to get all the appliances and everything else out.
Now, that's bizarre. So someone took all of their furniture and their belongings and just chucked it in the pool?
Yes.
Wow, that's weird. While you were having lunch or whatever?
Yeah, we never came back to the property until that night. You know, we were going to move in at like 7 o'clock in the morning. And then when we got there and all their stuff was still in the house like it hadn't been touched, we were like, you know, what's the deal? And so we turned around and called the realtor and, you know, screamed and, you know, stomped our foot. And, you know, and I asked him afterwards, I said, did you pull all that stuff out and throw it in the pool?
Yeah, I was about to say, did he do it?
He never went to the property or anything.
Wow. That is weird. So since that experience, I read that you've been visited by dozens of aliens that you call grays. So can you describe that?
Yeah. We've had the grays, but we've also had some really good things happen with positive aliens. You know, I mean, in 2001, I was diagnosed at Barrows Neurological with MS, and it was severe onset of MS. I took my driver's license away. You know, they told me to make my final arrangements because I'd probably be dead in 6 months. And went to see a friend of mine who was an important person who worked in the military, and he told me, he said, look, I know a guy who might be able to help you. And so I had a meeting with him at his office, and this tall, blonde man came in, and he just ran his hands about 6 or 8 inches away from my head and the rest of my body, and, you know, kind of just went up and down all over, and he turned around, he looked at me, and he goes, I can help you. And he said, come to this address. He gave me his address. I went there the following Monday with my wife. And he said, you know, thanks for coming. Come on in, sit down. I'm going to do a procedure with you. And it's not going to be like anything you've ever had done before, but it won't hurt you and it will help you. And I said, okay, great. And he handed me this like glass globe that was about the size of a small beach ball or like a, you know, like a basketball. And I turned around and sat down and had this thing in my lap. And he said to me, John, just kind of go with this. And I started to get this warm feeling. And there were all these like little tin foil, kind of gold colored pieces of tin foil or tinsel inside this glass ball. And suddenly it felt like warm water was kind of flowing over all my extremities and like I was in a shower or something. And that went on for about 20 minutes, and at the end of the 20 minutes, he said, how do you feel? And I said, I feel good. I feel really good. And he said, I think you won't have any more problems with the MS at all. And I said, what did you do to me? And he said, well, the gold that was in that glass ball, it's now inside of you, and it's coating all of the nerve endings all over the ganglia and all the places where the nerves go through your body, and it recoated all the places that were worn out and where the signal in the nerves was escaping. And he said, you won't have any more problems. Well, that was over 20 years ago. Wow. And I've never had a problem.
Wow, that's interesting. So was this guy a medical doctor?
No, not at all. He's an alien.
Did he look like an alien, or did he look like, or is he assuming a human form?
He was human form. He was tall. He's about six, I want to say about 6'6", 6'7". He had a long ponytail. He was very friendly, just good looking man. And, you know, he totally took care of business. And the best part was he didn't even charge me.
Wow. So have you ever seen this guy again? Ever do a follow-up appointment?
Yeah, I actually know him quite well. I've been friends with him ever since.
Did he tell you that, or did you ever ask him about his alien past or like what planet he's from?
He's a Pleiadian. There's lots of Pleiadians here. There's lots of Andromedans here. There's lots of Pleiadians, Arcturans. You know, there's tons and tons of aliens here on this planet. You know, everybody thinks that we own the planet, but you know what? We've been sharing the planet with all these guys for thousands and thousands of years. And they're all around us. They're in places, you know, in government. They're in, you know, Hollywood. They're singers. I mean, they're everywhere. And, you know, the idea that they're coming from the stars to invade us or something is preposterous. They're already here. You know, we're already integrated into the system. It's just that folks don't know it because the government won't acknowledge it. And, you know, they don't want to, you know, become a spectacle.
But didn't you say that some of these aliens are malevolent? Like you were forced to kill 18 of them?
Yeah, the grays are real bad. But understand something, and that is, you know, aliens are just like people. They aren't all good or all bad. You have to take them on an individual basis. And, you know, you have to create a relationship. I mean, you know, it's not like every human is good or bad. You know, there's, you know, all flavors, you know, in between.
So can you elaborate on the samurai sword incident? What happened?
Well, the samurai sword has happened a lot of times, and that is that I'm a true American. I believe in the Second Amendment. I believe in property rights, and I believe that I have a right to defend my property, my family, my, you know, personal honor and my safety. And I will do everything in my power to use the Constitution of the United States to protect my personal freedom and dignity.
Mm-hmm. So were you attacked by like 18 grays at once?
No, I was attacked over and over and over again individually. And my wife was attacked, and usually three of them at a time, but sometimes as many as seven.
Do they have weapons, or how do they fight?
Well, they don't really fight. What they do is it's a little hard to explain, but they don't move around like regular people do. They literally are able to move from space to space, almost kind of like a signal. And so once you get used to seeing how they move, you can kind of predict where they're going to be next, because they move very, very, very quickly. And so you have to kind of plot like where they're going to land, or where they're, you know, what's the probability where they're going to be next. And then you just have to be right there and kind of lead them a little bit, and you got them. You know, you got them red-handed, more or less.
So did you stab them, or like did you decapitate them, or how, what happened?
I have done everything from been in a situation where I had no weapon, where I grabbed them by literally the equivalent of what would be their ankles and picked them up and beat them against the brick walls of my house and killed them that way. I have, we have done hand-to-hand combat for 20 years, and it's, you know, 18 or 19 of them were killed, but there have been hundreds and hundreds of firefights where I've had to deal with these things.
Do they come in like a flying saucer or something, or do they have a spaceship of some kind?
Well, no. Actually, for the most part, what they do is our reality is kind of like an onion. If you peel it back, there's lots and lots and lots of interdimensional layers. And so what these creatures do is they're actually in a different dimension, slightly out of phase. And what they do is when they want to come into our reality, they literally just kind of stick their head through. And if they don't see anything, they step the rest of the way.
Like
and,
a portal.
Yes. But it's not really a portal. It's more like, I mean, it could happen any place, anywhere. It's, you know, we do have two portals, but those are not how these things travel. And, you know, they literally, we've had as many as 150 of these things, 160 of them at a time on this property. And that has been documented.
Why do you think they're attracted to this property? And you in particular? What's the name of that?
They've been coming here for at least 12,000 years is what we've been told. This particular property, but not only this property, but Rainbow Valley in general, is an electromagnetic hotspot. All the alien, the ability to travel is based on the electromagnetic spectrum. And there are certain places that are extreme power sources. And this is one of them.
So that's what they're drawn to it.
Well, they use it. They actually use the power in order to go other places. I mean, if you can imagine the equivalent of like a Stargate, we get ships that go through and use the portal that's on the back of the property. They'll come out about once every 90 days. The portal will light up and just start, it, you know, it's up in the sky. And these things, these ships, they'll go through 10, 12, you know, 15 of them in a few seconds, you know, both in and out of this space. You know, and I know that as much as the Air Force doesn't want to acknowledge this, I know that they have seen it, because I know people that are actually at Luke Air Force Base that have acknowledged the transmission of these things.
Can you travel through the portal?
I wouldn't. It's not my cup of tea. I'm not interested in that kind of experience. I'm sure people can. I've had offers, but I don't see that as the, you know, the thing that I want to do. I'm more or less a liaison between these different races, this property, and the people of the world. And I keep telling folks, you know, this is really, you know, as much as everybody thinks this is about aliens and sci-fi and all that kind of stuff, that's not what this is about. What this is really about is learning how to understand each other better. It's about love and kindness. It's about the idea that we need to elevate and change our way of thinking in this reality so that we can clean this whole place up and have the world that we really want. If we do that, we're going to have access to technology that can, you know, meet our wildest dreams and expectations in terms of things like health, you know, good food, free energy, all those kind of things. We have the ability to have all these things right now. We have wonderful, talented individuals. We have ETs that are willing to help. We have everything necessary to turn this world into a paradise if people would just step up and take responsibility and get involved. If they don't do this, this place is going to be the crap hole that it's been forever.
Yeah, I'm not sure our current government really wants to welcome extraterrestrial beings here.
You know what? We are our government. We are our government, and they're going to have no choice about it, and we're going to get this done whether they like it or not. And that's just too damn bad if they don't want to participate.
I agree. I think it's an eventuality. So if when you were attacked, just to go back to that for a second, and you managed to incapacitate the aliens, what did you do with the corpses? Do they disappear, or what happened?
If you don't take the head, they disappear, because it's like an antenna. Imagine breaking an antenna on a satellite dish, the signal stops, okay? If you don't break the antenna off, basically, it just, you know, they just disappear. And so the ones that were killed, their bodies remained.
So what did you do with the corpses? Did you ever, like, maybe contact the FBI or something and say, hey, I have this corpse of an alien that attacked me?
Yeah, and can you imagine just how well that would be received?
I don't think it'd go over well.
What I actually did was I went through a gentleman named Robert Collins, who is a retired Air Force captain, and I asked him what I should do, because, quite frankly, I'd never been in this position before. You know, social workers don't normally deal with aliens, and so it just wasn't really, you know, in my purview of life experience. And so, you know, I talked to him. He put me in touch with a guy that he said was very trustworthy, Dr. Levengood in Grass Lakes, Michigan. And I spoke to him at length. I sent him pictures. I, you know, sent him video, the whole works. And he said, well, it's dead. Chop it up and send it to me. And I said, okay, how do I get it to you? And he says, call FedEx, you know, put it in special boxes, wrap it up and send it to me. So that's what I did.
Wow. What did he say? Did he, like, analyze it or something?
Oh, yeah. He took all the samples, and what he did was he sent them off to, you know, various different universities around the country, special labs. He had the DNA done. He did an extremely good job of managing, you know, the specimens, and various different universities brought back reports. They didn't know what they were working with. They weren't told. They were just asked to analyze the tissues and to give an opinion, and that's what they did. And so I have a letter from him that says, John, you have the actual smoking gun of proof, of evidence of alien life on Earth.
I noticed there was a picture of the samurai sword that you used, and it looked like there was, like, red blood on the floor. Do these aliens, like, bleed red blood?
Well, they bleed a combination of stuff that kind of looks like the camera picks it up as blood, but it actually looks more like transmission fluid or brake fluid, and it makes kind of a mess. The problem with it is it's very acidic. And it's anything that it touches, it will actually leave a mark. It actually left a very large mark on the cement outside the door where that was.
John, do you have any children? Or do you have any kids? Have they ever?
No, sorry, Doc.
No, okay. Because I was wondering if have you had any other family members stay at the ranch and also have contact with these aliens?
No, but I've had a lot of friends. There's all sorts of people that have been here and seen it. We have witnesses. We have, you know, folks that come from all over the world and visit us. And, you know, we had one gal that came here in a wheelchair from Florida. And after about 15 hours here on the ranch with the high frequency energy here, she got up and started walking around, and she was able to feed the horses. And a week later, when she went home, we packed up her wheelchair and put it in storage. And, you know, as far as I understand, when she went back, she was fine.
Wow.
I have somebody here right with me now that came here trying to get over liver cancer, and she's been here 4.5 months, and she's totally in remission, and she's doing real well, if you want to speak to her.
Okay. All right. You can put her on.
Hold on a second. This is Gail Chasen. She's a famous blues musician out of Tennessee.
Hi, Gail.
Hi there. How are you?
Good. How's it going?
It's going great. I'm just happy and completely excited. You know, just to give you a little information, since the time I'm 4 years old, I've had experiences on my own. The biggest
with aliens?
Ones. Yeah.
Okay.
The biggest ones took place in the last 30 years. I have had 5 different species in my home in California within 2 feet of me talking. Yeah. In their alien bodies, not human
bodies. What did they look like?
Well, one was a reptilian, and he was exquisite, built like a brick, you know, what house. And except his head was a turtle, like kind of a looking thing. And I just turned and I looked at him and I said, "This isn't for you." And he just disappeared.
And course, what did he want? Like, why do you think he came to you?
I think he wanted sex, because there's different levels of, you know, there's like, it's like John was saying, there's people of all kinds, and they have warriors, and they have the lovers and the romantics, and then they have the ones that like to mess around with human women. And I I didn't know any of that at the time. I just looked at him, and what's amazing to me is I didn't even have any kind of reaction. I just went, "No, go away."
Well, part of my personal question, but have you ever actually had a sexual encounter with an alien?
Oh, no.
And
later I was told by somebody that those reptilians have two sets of organs. One is to have babies with their own, and one is for human women. And then I think it was about 2 weeks later, I saw this show called, it was really 1995 or 96, and it was called something like Belief. I'll go in the other room.
Is that an alien dog?
Yeah, he thinks he is. I've got a couple of rescues.
Oh.
Let's see. Then there was, they just have different levels, you know. Mm-hmm. I forgot where I left off. But anyway.
Well, I think you said they're warriors and lovers, and they actually do come to Earth
chemists,
have sex with humans.
They're chemists, and there's, you know, like we have different professions, you know. Mm-hmm. They do too, I guess, or categories or castes or whatever. And then I saw a show called something like Believe It or Not, and it was a good-looking young light-skinned black guy and a blonde woman, and he had been a newscaster. And the show only lasted maybe 8 months, and they took it down. But they showed a picture of a reptilian, and two women from different sides of the United States. Both of them were blonde. I have dark hair. Mm. And they were making claims that it was the best thing they ever had.
Wow.
They were human men.
Wow, that's interesting. I didn't know aliens were so horny.
Who knew? You know?
Yeah, well, no one would know that.
It's creation. That's all it is.
Exactly.
But here's the other thing. And then one night I was sleeping and something was bobbing like a balloon. And I woke up about 3:30 in the morning and I'm looking at this, like, it looked like a white balloon with a nose and a no neck. It was just like, just sort of filled with air, but it had little stars all over it and was really happy. And it kept saying, "Do you know who you are? Do you know who you are?" And I looked at him and I said, "Yeah, I'm Gail effing Chasen. Get the hell out of here. I'm sleeping." I turned right over and went back to sleep. You know, it's odd to me that I would, you know, see such unbelievable stuff. And then I must have had another life. I don't know. It amazed me. And then the biggest one I remember is, I was sleeping, taking a nap, and my dad, when I lived with him in California, and I was taking a nap in the afternoon, and I was awakened by something sitting on my chest, and I couldn't breathe.
That's
and I
scary.
Couldn't see anything. Oh, my God. And I'm trying to, like, scream out, you know, something, anything. And I wanted to yell, "Jesus, help me," right?
Mm-hmm.
And what I heard was, I couldn't get it out, so I thought it. "Jesus, help me." And all of a sudden, I could breathe, and the pressure relieved. And I got up, and I broke out into a cold sweat, and I ran into my living room, and there standing were seven short aliens, grays, covered in, like, these monk things with over their head.
Like Jawas.
But they were floating about 6 inches off the ground. They weren't standing. And then was a tall one, a tall gray, who I think they are kinder and more educated. But anyway, he was kind of keeping them all in order. Anyway, it was just, you know, they were trying to tell me something, not to go to Denmark, because I was thinking about playing there. And they said, you know,
don't do it. They don't like the Danes.
Well, they thought it would maybe, no, I don't think that's it. I think they thought I was going to get screwed up somehow over there.
So it was like a warning.
The language. They were protecting me. It was the weirdest thing.
That is really strange.
And so they get up. Well, the tall one, they just headed for the door. They're all floating. The door opened by itself. They're all floating outside, and I'm running after them, watching them as they stepped into the street. They vanished. None of my neighbors even saw it. And we were living in a 5-star coach park at the time, where our houses were like 5 feet from each other, but they were all 55 and older and deaf and blind and whatever.
This happened in California?
Yeah, Irvine.
Okay, wow, that's not even too far from us. We live in Los Angeles. You don't smoke marijuana, do you?
No.
Okay, so we can't attribute that then. One question that John brought up is that you had cancer, and so you came out to the ranch to seek treatment?
Yeah.
Tell me about that.
To recover. I had an ablation done by my doctors in Tucson, and fortunately, they caught it very early, so there was no chemo or any radiation involved. But when I just was not bouncing back, and I didn't feel good, and I was tired, and I wasn't motivated, and I wasn't writing my music, and I wasn't doing anything, because I was writing a book about this whole thing. And I just didn't feel motivated. And John and I had been friends for 3 years by telephone, and I'd made some trips out here to come visit him and meet his wife and hang out, and we took a few trips. And John is an unusually interesting and unique character. He's got integrity. He's honest. He's really bright. And he feels like a brother to me, you know, so... We just bonded. He was doing, initially we met on the phone. He was doing an interview with me on the internet from No Music. And then he said, as it got, you know, on and on, he says, "So what are you doing now?" I said, "I'm writing a book." He says, "What about?" I said, "UFOs." He goes, "Oh my God."
Yeah, like, we got to talk.
Yeah. And that's all she wrote. So my lease ran out in Tucson, and I got myself a little RV, and I'm I'm here on the property and with my dogs, and it's a whole new life. But I'm losing weight. I'm feeling better.
I wonder if this has to do with the magnetic field on this property.
Surprise. It was, but I got to tell you, the first day that I was here, I looked at my keys and a new cord that I had bought to charge my phone. Put my hand on them, turned away, looked back, gone.
Wow, the keys were gone?
Everything was gone, the cord, yeah, and never to return. I just came back from making keys. This kind of stuff happened. John has lost watches and diamond rings and all kinds of interesting things just go missing.
I gotta say that would drive me nuts. I think I'd move too.
We don't like it.
Well, I'm glad to hear that you're in remission, that you're feeling better. It makes me think that instead of selling the ranch, John should make it like a kind of a wellness center or something where visitors or guests could come.
Yeah, he thought about that, and anything is possible. It just sort of depends on what John gets, feels happy on any of his offers. It's a possibility, but I have a feeling he wants to go.
He's had to move on.
Yeah, it's very hot here, and
that's a good point.
It's hell.
It is Arizona. All right. Well, thank you, Gail, for chatting with us. It's very interesting. I look forward to checking out your book. If whenever you publish it, you should let us know. We'll have you back on the show.
I would be thrilled. Thank you so much. I'm going to hand you back to John,
okay.
Honey.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hey John, thanks for chatting with us. I was just telling Gail that it would be great if you guys had maybe turn the ranch into like a wellness center. Be better than a water park by Disney. You could have people come visit and check out aliens, go through the portal.
Yeah, well, the thing about it is we don't control the portals. You know, the portals just occur. This place didn't come with like a CD with instructions or a manual or anything. So, you know, we're basically observers just trying to figure it out. But, yeah, the healing center thing is something that we've looked at, and we're interested in it. I mean, if we get the right offer, if we get somebody that says, hey, you know, we'll give you enough money that you can go to Maine and get your stuff done there that you want to get done. Plus, you know, we'll pay to, you know, turn the place into a healing center. I would look at that very, very seriously.
Yeah, it sounds like it could benefit a lot of people. Well, thanks for chatting with us. It's been fascinating. And best of luck selling the ranch.
Good. Thank you. Thanks for having me on your show.
All right. Take care.